Good evening, everyone. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you all to this very interesting session on the impact of digital learning. We have a star-studded cast today. I would like to thank the PeopleBridge team for putting up this wonderful session. I would like to introduce our esteemed moderator for the day, Dr. Shalini Advani, who has been the principal of the British School, New Delhi, Director of Education of Learn Today, and currently the school director for Pathway School, Noida. She's one of the few people around who have headed various schools of various systems, including the IB, the GCSE, as well as CBSE schools. She has also been a member of the National Council for Education Research and Training, or the NCERT steering committee. And what is interesting about her is that she cares passionately about creating a dynamic educational environment for all children and believes that encouragement and a sense of humor are the most important tools for educators. I now hand it over to Dr. Shalini Advani to moderate this session and introduce Dr. Deepak Gupta, please. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mahesh, and thank you to PeopleBridge for creating this platform for us. It's wonderful to have an audience that is so varied, with different types of educators, different people involved with education or involved with child and development. So it's a cliche that we are living through an extraordinary time for which there really is no roadmap. It's a disruptive moment for society. We none of us know how our parents did it or how a different generation of educators did it. We're working our way along, making it up as we go and defining what are the new challenges that come up. We've had to reinvent what education looks like as learning has moved online. Suddenly, from telling children to limit screen time, they've been encouraged to stay on screen for 3 to 4 hours as schools have moved online. Now, all of this creates a lot of anxiety. A UK study has shown that 54% of parents worried about too much screen time. And in India, that is probably higher. One big challenge is for adults, because the situation is what is the opposite of what we've always believed good parents should say. We worry about the loss of human contact for our children. We worry that there's not enough healthy physical activity and that children are on screen. So in this extraordinary time, I think it's important for us to think about what is a good area for worry, if there is such a thing, and what is coming from our own anxiety to be good mentors, to be good coaches to our children, or to be good parents. In other words, what is important to be concerned about? And what is it that should be accepted for this extraordinary moment? What is digital addiction? And is this time leading to that? So I'm very delighted to have here Dr. Deepak Gupta, who's going to be assisted by Dr. Navanita Sengupta. Dr. Gupta is an eminent child and adolescent psychiatrist from Gangaram Hospital. He also heads the Center for Child and Adolescent Wellbeing. So he's really the perfect expert to talk to us about this. Before I hand over to him, I want to say that we'd be really happy to answer as many questions as we can after he has talked. So please put them in the chat box and either he or I will take up the questions depending on what they are. And please do in the meanwhile, continue to keep yourselves on mute while Dr. Gupta talks. So Dr. Gupta, let me hand over to you so that we get this session rolling.
First of all, good evening, everyone. And thanks to People Bridge, thanks to Mahesh, and thanks to Shaliji for the kind words. Today, I will be talking about digital learning impact on mental and physical health of students in present scenario. This is the brief outline of my presentation. I'll be talking about digital learning in the present scenario. What are the benefits and challenges? What can be the possible impact on the mental and physical health and the future roadmap? And then we'll take questions and question and answers. Now, digital learning in the present scenario, if we talk about, the corona pandemic has made a global impact in the past months. We're almost in the third month of the lockdown, and it continues to impact most of the sectors, with education being one of the most affected. Nobody thought of that corona will come somewhere and we will go into a lockdown on 24th of May, March. And since then, that was a time when most of the schools, except few other schools of IB board and other schools, they were planning to start the new curriculum. The new curriculum was about to start. The 10th and 12th boards were about to finish. And suddenly, on 18th or 19th, we get the news that the board exams are postponed. So the whole everything impact on the education could be seen. Students across the world were losing valuable time in their education. People who were studying abroad, they came to the country. They came back to India. They took the tickets, flight, and they rushed back across the country to their hometown and also from across the world. People who were doing studies, they were concerned what will happen, how they will finish the whole curriculum year. So the situation forced the school to, and colleges to shut down and the students to stay at home. It was not something which they wanted. It just came as a surprise and we had to welcome it for the safety and security of the society and the nation. At such a time, it was forcing this extended lockdown, and initially 3 weeks, then 3 weeks, then 2 weeks, then 2 weeks, and now 1 month, this extended lockdown period forced the education sector in India to rapidly evolve. People started experimenting because it was absolutely a new experience. As Shaliji mentioned, nobody was aware of it, what to do, kya kare, what to do it. People were in dilemma. Should we go ahead? Should we not go ahead? And some of the schools, they waited for some few weeks before they started online classes. So it was a very, very absolutely a perplex situation for everyone. And finally, most of the schools and institutions decided and they came up with the idea of online classes for students to start their respective academic years instead of wasting time due to delay in reopening of the schools. So this is the current scenario we are seeing that. And a lot of schools on 30th of May, they have finished their online classes and they've gone for an official summer vacation, which is official summer vacation, which happens in the month of May and June. That is where we are. I want to emphasize, I want everyone to look into this absolutely very interesting study by Lifeology. As just now Shaliji mentioned about that 53%, around 54%, in fact, she said that 54% of parents are worried about children being on the online. And this study, which was conducted by Lifeology India across 14 states, and around 38,000 parents participated in this study along in the middle of this COVID-19 crisis, they revealed that 61% of the families are opting for e-learning. That means e-learning is something people are saying, okay, let's take it, let's go ahead for it. It's a very, very big number. But this study also emphasized, I want to put a point to it, that 27% of parents were concerned that there is no physical activity. And 24% said that we don't have anything interesting to offer to children. But there was one silver lining also in this study, though it is slightly different from a topic, that 90% of them felt that there was enough time to bond. The relationships took a new turn. There was a lot of bonding, closeness, which came up in this. So there was a silver lining to this whole cloud, absolutely. So 61% of families opted for e-learning in this 38,000 parent survey across 14 states by Lifeology. Now let's see, this whole digital education, What are the benefits? Correct? And if you see in this five benefit, which I put it across on the slide, is that easy accessibility. Easy accessibility with a mobile, laptop, and internet connection. If you have a mobile, if you have a laptop, if you have an internet connection, that's what you want. And you are connected to digital learning. You can learn. The teachers absolutely let you connect with it. There's no commuting required. You don't have to get up 7 o'clock in the morning, get ready, put the school uniform, and get ready to catch a bus or the car or carpool or go to the school. No commuting required. You get up at 8:45 also and attend the 9 o'clock class and continue doing your breakfast or in between the breaks. So no commuting required. No, that structure is required like the way you have in a regular day to day. But yes, you have to class from 9 to 1 or 9 to 2, depending on the school to school. Also, this digital learning allowed innovative methods of teaching because teachers were not prepared for it. It was an absolutely a new experience for teachers. Unless in some of the schools who were already on the online e-learning, were already doing online learning and e-learning, they were okay, they were comfortable. But for a lot of schools, most of the schools across the country, they were not used to the e-learning, except PowerPoint presentation in the classroom, that's all. They had a smart board in the classroom, that's what, correct? Some notes used to go on the emails, but there was no particular proper e-learning system. But when this digital learning came, the school had to look for the innovative methods of teaching, a different creative methods of teaching, how to involve students, how to make sure the maximum curriculum is covered, how to make sure that maximum children are able to finish the course. That's what. And how to make sure that the children are involved in the teaching. Because that's what we'll talk in the digital learning is one of the biggest barrier which comes in digital learning is the digital system itself, which that means you're not face to face. So the new innovative methods of teaching came up. Another point which also came up is convenient to fit into the day. Yes, children were able to fit into the day because in the first half, 9 to 1, 10 to 1, so they were able to manage, they were able to do other things, and the 10 to 1, they were in front of the screen and doing the digital learning. And the important part, the social distancing of coronavirus, physical distancing, which we talk about, don't get out of the house, keep physical distancing of 6 feet, you know, do gaj duri rakhi apne, bachok sab ke saath. So that social distancing was able to exercise. So all these things, that means education came to your bedroom. The learning system, the school came to your bedroom. Abhi tak aap jin phone ko kehte the, phone ko dur rakho, keep your phones away. Now the education was on the phones. So it was becoming as if everything was at your fingertip, at your own convenience. So convenience, social distancing was exercised, innovative method of teaching, no commuting required, and easy accessibility. So these all were the benefits of digital learning. Now let's see the challenges of digital learning, correct? Mahesh, please look into it. Somebody is just working on the screen. Can you request a participant not to touch the screen, please?
Yes.
Yeah. So challenges of digital learning. Now, this is something. And what I've put here, this is not only my perspective. I do every day I do 10 to 12 online sessions with students across the country. And these are the input by various students who has given me, including my daughter. She's in class 11th and the elder one is in first year doing liberal arts. And so I've asked their inputs also. I've asked other students also. I've asked the children who come, teenagers who come to me for emotional help also. And after that, I put them, all of them, into this slide. And one of the most important thing is intense requirement of self-discipline. We need maximum amount of self-discipline because the responsibility is entirely upon the student to complete the work, to complete the studies, to get up on time, to focus and to concentrate. So the student becomes a very, very important in digital learning because he need to have the self-discipline. Because if he's not self-disciplined, he will not get up on time and attend the 9 o'clock classes. If he's not disciplined, he will not finish the work. If he's not disciplined, he will not sleep on time. Otherwise, he sleep at 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock. At a 9 o'clock class, he will be just feel groggy and sleepy. That's one of the biggest challenges, self-discipline. Second, important point, the students were not able to have face-to-face interaction with the teachers. Some of them said, unless we are in the classroom in front of the teachers, we can't connect with the teachers. We can't communicate with the teachers. Teachers come, they teach online, they go away. So we are not able to have a real interaction. We don't have the emotional connect with the teachers. And when we don't have the emotional connect with the teachers, we can't learn properly. We can't concentrate. We can't focus. Some of the students also mentioned that you should have good time management skills. If your time management skills are not good, then you can't be on time. And then you can't finish your classwork, whatever is given, whatever homework is given, you can't do it. And it becomes a very chaotic if you are struggling. So you need to have a good time management skills. And some of the students also mentioned to me that you have to attend one class after another class. And when you have to attend one class after another class, you sometimes they're not prepared for it. There are not enough breaks. But some of the schools do have a break. So it was a mixed response, which I got it from some of the students. Another important challenge of digital learning is lack of interest and poor motivation. They don't have any interest now. Before, they used to go to school, they used to get ready, they have to meet their friends, teachers, you know, they have to play physical ground, they used to get a lot of fun, a lot of activity, school canteen. So a lot of motivation to go to school and then attend the classroom. But now, a lot of students said, we don't have any interest. They're quite motivated, poorly motivated for studies and homework. And also, little practical experience while learning online. They said, we are not used to it. We were used to PowerPoint presentation, and a lot of time the presentations are not very clear. A lot of time the presentations are not point-wise. They're too heavy presentations. We can't grasp, we can't catch up, and the teachers are in a hurry to finish the curriculum. So all these things are really, really, really practical experiences they are facing while learning online. Then technological difficulty. Sometimes the internet connection is not good in your home. Sometimes the internet connection is not good in the teacher's home. Sometimes your device is not properly placed. Sometimes your phone is not charged up. The battery is not adequately charged. You are working, you are just enjoying till 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, watching a movie. And suddenly you get up in the morning, oh my God, the phone is not charged fully. And suddenly you lose connection in between. So technology is difficulty. And that's what happens. And when you're studying at home and with family, again, a lot of distractions can be there. In the family, there can be a lot of distraction. The family is moving. Everybody's working from home. So a lot of difficulties can be there. And one important point, the peers and technology-related distractions. You're in front of the screen, but still you're not in the front of the screen. You're sitting, they're watching you, the school people, but you're busy on another phone. You're busy on your iPad and you're chatting. You're having house parties. You're playing tambola. You're doing other things. So peers and technology-related distractions. So you're sitting in front of it and still you're not learning. So all these are the various challenges of digital learning which students are facing. So a lot of self-discipline, lack of face-to-face interaction, time management issues, poor motivation, less practical experience, technological challenges, studying at home, family and peer technology-related distractions. Now let's see from a teacher's point of view. I really salute the teachers and really hands off to all the teachers who are attending, how suddenly they have to shift from the face-to-face to the online. It was not easy for teachers. It was an absolutely a different ball game for the teachers who were not used to it. So it was a big pressure on the teachers to complete the curriculum time. Unko bol di gaya, they were set, finish the curriculum. But were they ready? Were they trained? Were they prepared? No. They were just asked to do a duty, which a lot of them were not ready. And second major challenge which teachers had was inability to have face-to-face interaction with their students. They were not able to monitor the students. Whatever the students are doing, they are not aware of it. They were just finishing the curriculum. That absolutely very, very difficult thing. And simultaneously, the teachers, because they were also managing the household, because there were a lot of households were not there, maids were not there, help was not there, the whole family and household chores, they would have to do it because we have a lot of female teachers into it. So along with the classroom, e-classroom, along with this managing family household chores, you need to have good time management skills. And if you don't have good time management skills, it will be a chaos. Chaos at your personal level, at the education level, and at your house level. And a lot of teachers never had practical experience while teaching online. So some of the students told me that teachers were giving them too much of work. Too much of work was going on and they were teaching them very fast. They were not able to understand the pace of students. Also, teachers felt that their children are free, but children were so busy also after classrooms, after e-class, that they had so many things to do. There's so many things to enjoy, so many things to create, so many things to watch. So, but then how, then homework was too heavy for them. So too much of homework, which was coming up. So to these practical difficulties. And again, as I mentioned in the previous slide, technology difficulties, that internet connection, device issues. Another point which is coming up is that children with special needs. I want to emphasize, because some of the schools have children with special needs in the mainstream education. And when the children with special needs have in the mainstream education, what is required is the teacher has to have give more input and supervision. They need to have more support from the learning center. More support from the learning center, more one-to-one interaction, more one-to-one support, extra time, modified curriculums, all those things. So the point was that in digital learning, was it taken care of? Have we addressed those issues of children with special needs or learning difficulties? Children with disabilities, correct? So this is another point which has to be taken care of, and coordination with the parents. Now, when children were studying at home, the parents became very curious. They wanted to know what exactly happening in the child's life. They were curious to know how the teachers teach their children. What is the teaching style? Is the teacher is able to connect? So a lot of teachers felt under scrutiny, but a lot of teachers felt as if, you know, they were constantly being observed by the parents. And also some of the parents felt that they should get more input from the teachers, and more coordination should be between parents and teachers so that they can also teach their children, because they were at home, they had more time. So these various challenges of digital learning, that pressure on teacher, inability to have face-to-face interaction, time management issues, practical experiences, technology issues, children with special needs, and coordination with parents and input to the parents. So you see how many challenges we had, we are having, still having. Now let's move to the third part of my presentation, which is impact on the mental and physical health. Now I put everything together.
Can we remove those doodles, please? Please avoid touching the keypads. Thank you.
Yeah. So impact on the mental health, very, very important. And I've deliberately used this word apathy and poor motivation here. I was thinking whether shall I put it or not, but I have a lot of thinking I put this word. And why I put this apathy and poor motivation is that because a lot of students felt boredom. They felt so boring, the classrooms. They were so bored. They said they were not interested. The classrooms, e-classroom were not interesting. They couldn't get that interest. It was like an apathetic perspective towards learning and education. So this apathy, in that is an important psychological concept. If you have apathy and poor motivation, definitely your output and production will decrease. One of the biggest challenges. Second thing which also came of that, because the whole structure of day to day was getting impacted, the sleep cycle was getting altered. The children used to sleep at 10 o'clock, 11 o'clock before lockdown and before these things, when we went before the lockdown, they were sleeping at 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock. I know till 5 o'clock they were sleeping. And when they're sleeping too late, the whole system got altered. And we know that there's a very, very important hormone called melatonin, which is released when we switch off the lights and when we sleep at 10 o'clock at 11 o'clock. And that hormone is very, very important for the whole circadian rhythm, because sleeping at the right time, it helps you to regenerate your whole system. You get refresh the way you put a refresh button in your laptops. And if the refresh doesn't happen, then you are absolutely the whole day, you're in a fatigue, you're tired, you're not able to focus and concentration. So sleep cycle was getting altered. The third thing is that which impact on the mental health is the excessive use of internet. Shaliniji absolutely said right. Up till now, we were saying don't use too much of net, but now we were forced to use the internet. But I want to tell you one thing to all the people attending. Digital learning versus digital addiction, they are both absolutely different. When we're doing a digital learning, there's a purpose. When we're doing a project, when we're doing homework, when we're doing classwork, there's a purpose to it, and that is digital learning. Correct? We are using the technology for a purpose and for a right way, for a right thing. Correct? So in that, you may have to use a project. If you want to finish a project, you may take 6 hours, 8 hours also. That's okay. But internet addiction is something where there's no purpose. You're using for gaming, you're using for social media, you're using for fun time. That is what. And that becomes internet addiction. And gradually, a lot of time, the digital learning can become into digital addiction. And there's a very thin line. The thin line is that when it is impacting and affecting your day-to-day life, when it is affecting your studies, when it is affecting your day-to-day functioning, that means whatever your hobbies like dance, singing, music, all those gets washed off. So if technology is impacting your studies, is impacting your day-to-day functioning, is impacting your extracurricular activities, is leading to a lot of conflicts, and is causing a chaos in your whole structure, and you're having a craving for it, that means you're going for digital addiction or internet addiction or a social media addiction. Now also, simultaneously, a lot of children, teenagers became very irritable, very angry, very defiant, because they were forced to get up in the morning and study. They have to get up at 8:45, 8:55. They just get up with their, you know, night suits. Suddenly wear a shirt or t-shirt, you know, comb up and all, wash their face and set up. And they are not ready. They said, we are not interested. And after the class, they used to become irritable, very, very angry. All those things used to happen, you know. And then when that happens, so what happens is that, then when that happens, you know, a lot of defiance, angry happens, a lot of conflict issues happen between the parents and the teenager. So you see so many teenagers that got angry and defiant. Another mental health challenge became inability to focus and inattention. And the major change which happened was that, again, because of sleeping late in the night, not interested in studies, not able to connect with the teachers, not able to have face-to-face, busy with their peer on the smartphones or other phones simultaneously, but while they are doing it, so they were not able to focus, and there are a lot of inattention issues came up. Some of the teenagers and some of the students, they developed anxiety and depression. And the, one of the reasons of anxiety was that peer performance issues or peer pressures. They felt when they were in the e-classrooms, they felt a lot of pressure from the teachers, or they felt as if they have to compete and submit their work on time, too much of time, or they felt they were not able to deliver, and they were not able to cope up with the e-curriculums, and the work were too much. So maintaining a balance between the school curriculum and the home pressures, simultaneously their own peer pressures, led them to anxiety and some of them depression. So you see, so much impact on mental health, from apathy, poor motivation, to sleep cycle alteration, digital addiction versus digital excessive use, irritability, anger, inattention issues, and anxiety, depression. There were also physical health issues. Lack of physical activity, tiredness, because they were limited to the four walls. Everything was on the screen. Everything was done on the screen. There was no movement, no physical activities, no breaks. You get up, you're on the screen. You sleep, then you get up, again screen. You eat some refreshments, you're on the screen. Yes, so that was leading to lack of physical activity. And simultaneously, because there was no fatigue, so definitely oxidative stress in the body was increasing. And that oxidative stress, when was it increasing? A lot of tiredness, a lot of fatigue, a lot of tiredness. The second thing, because they were sitting in front of the screen, excessive snacking was there, eating processed foods, packaged foods, junk food, obesity, weight gain. Another thing which came up a lot is posture-related problems. Because they were sitting constantly in front of the screen, that was leading to a lot of posture-related problems, like backache, neck pain, backaches, because they were not maintaining the right posture. If you're not sitting in the L position, if you're not sitting straight on the chair, if you're lying on the bed, louching on the bed, then what happens? You tend to have posture-related problems of too much of use. So the distance is at the right distance is important. The right posture is important. And if you're going very close to the screen, you will get high eye strain, pain in the eyes, irritability in the eyes, redness of the eyes, and headache. So you see how much on the physical health, lack of physical tiredness, obesity, fatigueness, posture-related problems, backache, neck pain, eye strain, headache. Now, amidst all these things, up till now I've told about the current scenario, I've told about the benefits and challenges, I've told about the impact on the mental and the physical health. Now let's see what could be a future roadmap. And let me tell you, whatever I'm presenting now, it is my own perspective after a lot of input from teachers, parents, students, and children who come to me, and including my own children and my wife. So after all so many inputs, I put certain future roadmap. Let's see. The first thing is that, what does the future hold? We need to invest in creating a standardized, sustainable online education platform. Every word is important. Need to invest. Because we don't know what is the ideal situation. We don't know what is the ideal platform. We don't know. There's so many platforms available, from Zoom, from Google, from Hangout, from Microsoft Teams. So many are available. Cisco, WebEx, so many are available. We don't know which one is the best one, which is the best thing to monitor. What is the right one, which can really stand the time? We don't know it. So we need to invest in creating a standardized, sustainable online education platform. The platform which is child-friendly, which is teacher-friendly, and which also helps parents also. And it is not one day affair. It has to go on for months. And we don't know when the school will open up. July, August, September, October, or the whole year, or 2021. We don't know. Also, we need to keep in mind the accessibility and other technology challenges. Because we know technology technology is an icing on the cream, icing on the cake. It's absolutely a boon to us in today's world. But then also, technology can have a lot of challenges. So we have to keep in mind those issues. Because sometimes technology may not be available to the lower socioeconomic strata. Technology may not be sometimes helpful for children who doesn't know how to use technology. Correct? So we need to look for it that we can address all the strata. We need to have certain programs which are designed specially for children with special needs. I work with a lot of children with special needs, and there's so many softwares are there which are used for children with special needs. So they have to get like a mainstream inclusive education. The for software and technology modalities for children with special needs has to be integrated, and the right inclusive education has to be planned for them. The third point, very, very important, emphasis on the physical and mental well-being. There has to be adequate breaks should be there. Emphasis on yoga should be there. After every half an hour, there should be 2 minutes break for the eyes should be there. The stretching exercise should be there. Concentration exercise should be there. 2 minutes silence should be there. You know, 2 minutes chanting, om chanting should be there. Correct? Other things should be talked about. A lot of humor should be there. Mahesh was introducing our Shalini about the humor. The humor, very, very important. It just relaxes you. That should be there. So that's all this emphasis on physical and mental well-being should be there. And then only you get the best capacity out of the children. I totally believe if you want the right education, you also have to create right students. The right students with right education creates right human beings. That's absolutely important. Another point which is important, we need to train both students and teachers. The training has to be done in this online education. The students were not prepared, the teachers were not prepared, they were not trained how to do it, conduct, and suddenly they all were told, let's do it. We all just went into it, crossing the bridge as it comes. So the proper protocol should be done, SOP should be made for students and teachers, and then proper classes, proper workshops should be done, and then after that, it should be put into place. Another important point, need to understand the utility of digital learning across all academic disciplines and institutions. So we have to know that there are different academic disciplines and institutions are there. So we have to make sure that we don't get biased through one strata. We don't get biased towards one academic discipline or science stream or a commerce stream or humanities stream. No, it should be across all academic disciplines, across institutions. So that sort of a thing should happen, you know, that digital learning should be used across all of them. And the last important point, parents. We have to involve parents in this whole system. We have to have their voice. We have to listen. What is their perspective? What do they have to say? What is their input? Look, the child is sitting at home and they are the biggest contributor. What teachers can do, parents can do, and what parents can do, teachers can do. So we have to work in a partnership. We have to bridge what we can't bridge. So that sort of collaboration and partnership has to be done. So investing in creating a standard sustainable online education platforms, keeping in mind accessibility and other technological challenges, emphasis on physical mental well-being, need to a lot of training, understand the utility across all discipline institutions, and involving parents. So I'll stop at this point of time. Thank you very much to everyone for this patient listening. I've been talking for the last 30 minutes, and now I hand over to Shalini ji to take it forward. Thank you very much. Once again, thank you, Dr. Deepak.
It was wonderful. Over to Dr. Shalini now. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Gupta. That was really a rich talk with so many different aspects that you've covered. It was also interesting to see how it was a very practical talk. You came down to the day-to-day reality that is faced by children, by parents, by teachers, and the many things that you covered, which is, you know, looking at the challenges looking at the benefits and looking at mental and physical health issues and even providing a roadmap for the way we should go ahead, I think it's really very valuable for anybody who is engaged with education. In some ways, the challenges that you have raised and the difficulties that people are facing, it seems to me are almost like a sharpened version of existing difficulties. They're arising out of those of existing difficulties in the sense things that existed even before we went on to online learning. So, for instance, if we look at the question that everybody doesn't have adequate access, and that in itself creates a lot of stress. It creates stress in teachers whose bandwidth is shaky. It creates stress in students who are missing out on content. That's really a visual indicator of this huge digital divide, which is part of a larger social divide that we have in our country. And the digital is bringing out the strains of it, but it is there with stresses and strains for young people who are trying to learn in every different way. Similarly, this whole aspect of teachers having to plunge into something that they don't adequately know or are not adequately prepared for really indicates some of the very big challenges we have with teacher training in a larger sense. And yes, at this time, teachers have come out as absolutely heroic because they have tried. They have tried their best to move to a platform that they're not familiar with. And there has been little bits and patches of training. There are only some institutions that have gone in for solid teacher training because leading to also the other area that you talked about, that children are often bored. Now, that is not inevitable with online learning.
Very true.
You can have processes if only teachers have those skills of ensuring collaboration and group work and discussions. You can have different ways of assessing, not just pen and paper tests, but looking at what children are able to share, what they're able to do, models that they can create at home. All of these things, you have to think about learning and assessment in different ways. So this whole aspect of child-centered pedagogy is become even more important for teachers and for education systems to bring on with that. A couple of other points. One is that, as you said, there's a lot of strain and stress physically, emotionally, there's a lot of fatigue that children go through. And this points again to a much larger need in education to teach children mental resilience. You know, you very nicely spoke about the importance of meditation, the importance of chanting. These are strategies that are really important and effective, and there are others as well, of course. But yes, children need that because this is a time of anxiety and fear in children. And I think we need to understand where that anxiety in a child's mind comes from. For children, they don't have the sense of long time that adults had. So, you know, we know as adults that this is a temporary phenomenon. Hopefully in 6 months, 8 months, 10 months, it'll pass. For children, their present is often their future. They don't have a sense of difference in time. And so the present that they're living in seems to be full of danger, seems to be full of fear. And I'd like to, of course, ask you to talk a little bit more about those aspects in a moment, about anxiety and fear and all of that for children. And one other area, which is the whole involvement of parents. You see, this is a very interesting dilemma that has come up for schools and for teachers, because suddenly our classroom doors have opened up to the entire community. And parents are sitting in and listening and commenting on how teachers are doing, how learning is happening. You know, ideally, this is how societies should have education. We should, in an ideal world, have a situation where parents are partners, and you spoke about that very nicely. And to do that, we have to get parents to understand what learning is and how it is happening, so that they can also see what is happening in class and be able to appreciate it. So this is another important lesson, I think, for schools, is when we go back to open schools, we really have to rethink how we are relating to parents. Often in schools in this country, we tend to shut the doors on parents and say, you know, you stay out. What happens inside the school is our business. And that is not really a healthy way of educating. So I'm just going to pause and ask you to take up some of these, and then we'll come to some of the questions that are in the chat as well.
See, ma'am, you have absolutely highlighted, you have summarized everything together, ma'am. That absolutely, I really liked your point that it is a sharpened version of the current existing system. So it is not something new which has come up. It was already there, and now it has come in a more refined, more sharpened way. And suddenly it has come to everyone. People who were not looking and ignoring and getting blind to it also have suddenly put their eyes into it, because they have to face it now. And that's, I think, absolutely well taken, ma'am. That's the point, is that they have to deal with it. Now, coming to the point is that, yes, the parent should always be partner to education. I totally believe into it. It should not be that it should come into a crisis only. The parents should be stakeholders, and they should be partners. They should be partners from starting, from inception also. And I've seen that when they have a voice in the right way, I'll emphasize this point, when they have a voice in the right way, correct, and that balance is done by the school administration and the school management, it really makes a difference. It really makes a difference to the school capacity and the teachers and the students' well-being. A lot of time it can be intimidating, you know, if parents get a voice. But that's what I tell. If the parent gets the right voice in the right way by the administration, that can be really, really helpful for the well-being of the student, because a lot of times, a lot of students get lost. You know, I've seen that. The bright ones just sail through. The average one and the back ones, they really get lost a lot of times. So the important point is that parents should be partners from inception and always possible. The another point about the fear and anxiety. See, we are living in a society. Even before Corona, we always had this fear and anxiety. And we are human beings. If anybody says, I don't have a fear and anxiety, I can't believe it. Everybody has a fear and anxiety. If I'm a child psychiatrist also, I'm into a lot of spirituality also, I'm a part of Brahma Kumaris also. But then also, some fear, some anxiety do comes in you sometimes. But then how you regulate it, that's important. And parents have to be role model. Because today's children are so vulnerable. I believe every child, whether child with special needs or without special needs, child living in upper class, middle class, lower class, every child is vulnerable. From abuse to the harm, from emotional challenges to depression, to self-harm, to substance abuse, correct? So sleep problems to addictions. So there's so much of spectrum is there. So important is that the parents have to be a role model. They have to be in partnership. And I always use this called ABC. This is my practical ABC, which I always use in all the presentation. A means acknowledgement and appreciation. I want every parent to understand that please appreciate and please acknowledge. And that same thing can be done by some of the teachers. I'm sure teachers are the best people to appreciate. They are born with that, you know, the talent to appreciate. So appreciation for the parents and acknowledgement. The B, be calm and vigilant. If you're not calm and not vigilant, you will tend to miss and overfire. You will tend to miss certain cues which you should have picked up. And C, the very important in today's world, connect with your child. And communicate with your child. If you do these three ABC, appreciation, acknowledgement, be calm and vigilant, and see, connect and communicate, every parent can make a difference. So these are some of my things in overall. And I think now we can take some of the questions and take it forward, ma'am.
Yes. So One question that I'd like to begin with is a practical one. If schools open in June or July, is it safe?
Ma'am, it all depends on the policy. See, right now the government has said that before we go into unlock, we are already unlock one has started from yesterday. And they are very clear by end of this month or early next month, they will decide about the phase two and which is the about the school and college. We know we have almost touched 2 lakhs. Today morning, the figure was 1,98,000. So we are almost touching 2 lakhs, ma'am. So my point too is that the government will do in the best interest of children. The CBSEs are conducting exams in first week of July. The results will be out at the end of this. Completed exams are happening in July end. But whatever the government will decide. So I'll tell to the parents, don't be in a panic situations. The government are asking for the parents for their inputs. Please send your inputs to the government and the policymakers. Whatever the government will do, they will take a best decision for your child. Because they're also scared. Because the schools have thousands of children, 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 or 500 children. So they also want to be very careful about that the coronavirus thing does not spread because they will be coming. So have patience, wait for the guidelines, and let's not press the panic button.
Another question, how can we prepare children for school after the lockdown? It's related to the previous one.
Absolutely, same thing. Communication, education. I really want to say, please don't overload your children with information. And also don't overload yourself also. Don't keep on sitting in front of NDTV, Aajtak or Delhi, Doordarshan and your mobiles and constantly looking the scores, numbers and getting the info. No. Just see what is happening in the morning and the night. If anything is important, that will flash. Don't worry about it. So don't be part of the information overload. Be selective, be careful, because that tends to really, really upset you. And so have a good communication with the children at the dinner time or the lunch time. Talk to them, think what they know it, and then prepare your child.
Okay, thank you. There's a question about life skills. How, again, during the lockdown time, how can we present or develop life skills in children?
Very good question, ma'am. I really like one of the quotations by the previous CBSE chairperson. I think she just stepped in the second week of May. She has been given some other responsibility. And while she was in the office in the month of April 2020, when the lockdown started, she gave a very good write-up, which came up in the media in the second week of April. And she said that, please explore your house. She said, please develop life skills at home. She said the school should get involved in the life skills at home. And she said, your kitchen is the biggest laboratory and where you can do as many experiments as you can. That was her comments, and I really appreciate that, because what you can teach your children at home. So when you're working in the kitchen, a lot of things will spoil. A lot of things will get this thing. You will go into argument, discussions, while you're baking, cooking, while you're washing, while you're cleaning, while you're chopping, while you're cleaning the whole kitchen. So a lot of things can be done. And while you're doing it, talk it out. Share your experiences. Share your journey. Listen to the child journey and develop. So conflict resolution, one of the biggest life skills, conflict resolution, decision making, assertiveness, all these life skills can be developed. Sharing, problem solving, very, very important. So all these life skills can be taught in day-to-day examples at home while you're working along, and naturally it happens. I don't want you to think like a counselor. Do it naturally. You should do it in a natural way. Like while you're taking care of a plant, and plant gets spoiled, how you should take care of the plant, how you should put the right, how much water, how should you put the mud, how should you clean up this thing. While you're doing it, that is the time you deal about the problem solving. If something happens in the kitchen and something gets broken up, a few days back, my daughter was sitting on the corner of the sofa and there was a glass bottle. She was getting up and then it got broken. And next day again, it happened, same thing. So I asked her, what you should do next time? And then she said, after that, no bottle has broken. So my point is that you need to reflect back onto children the right way. You as parents, it can get irritable. But when you reflect back and let them think through, and get the answer from them and give them the responsibility, life skills develop. Life skills come out from them naturally.
You know, one of the really essential things that you have said is that education is really not something that needs to happen only in school classrooms.
Absolutely.
Absolutely right what you're saying, that it is part of life around us, and there is so much learning which children get from parents, and parents often think that the learning that they can give is the general areas, which is, you know, to be good human beings or to care for others. But I think it's important for parents to recognize how much knowledge they have, which in fact go beyond what teachers have. Sometimes it could be to do with the job or the career you're doing as a parent. Educate your child into that. You always know more about the way the world works than a child knows. And that's really important knowledge to share with children. And all of that is education. Now, related to that, another question which had come up earlier, which is about, is digital learning workable or good for very young children?
When I came to know that the children were in nursery and kindergarten, 4-year-old, 3.5-year-old, and 4.5-year-old getting online classes, I was absolutely perplexed, and it was a surprise to me. I really want to know why we want to do online classes for 3 to 5-year-old. That's a question which was coming to my head. And I was thinking, I kept on thinking about it, and I 2 days back, we had a very long discussion with my other colleagues across the country also, that why a 3 to 5-year-old need to have an homework or need to have an online classes? Why can't they play and explore the world and learn in experiential learning? Why they can't learn in the four walls of the house from the parents and the siblings? Why can't they be creative and innovative and learn from day-to-day experiences? Why you want to post education into their online system, which they don't know what a screen is? And they're seeing a teacher popping in front of the screen and, oh my God, hello ma'am, they can't know. So my thing is I'll request the people on the education policy makers and the system to look into it, whether we really need to have online classes for nursery and the KG kindergarten pre-primary system. We need to really think of it. And how desperate are we to give them that education, first of all?
So if I can a little bit answer that question that you're posing, you're absolutely right that per se on-screen is not a requirement for 3 to 5-year-olds. If children can be guided to learn and think by parents,
absolutely.
The challenge is that parents often don't quite know what to do with their child. So it is useful for education systems to send out learning plans to parents, which will help them to teach children about basic things that schools teach them anyway. Matching and coloring and counting and, you know, those sorts of things are things that if parents are guided, they can certainly do. But I will say one other thing, that a little bit of on-screen time for children, and I would say probably 20 to 30 minutes a day, the advantage of that has been, as I have seen, that children who are used to being with the teacher, you know, children particularly at that age, often get very fond of their teacher, and they're looking for that connect with the teacher. So to just be able to see that teacher, to sing a nursery rhyme together, to get some of that, can have a good, healthy mental impact on them.
Absolutely.
So yes, in a limited way, you can have, some of them are doing this baby yoga, all of these sorts of things, singing.
More like an experiential. Absolutely. It should not become like a homework or a classwork. It's more like an experiential. I totally agree with you, ma'am.
Right. Yes. Moving to other one question that again has come up repeatedly is the challenge for children with special needs.
Yes, ma'am.
Would you like to address that?
I think what is important is that the SEND department should be involved into it. A lot of schools have SEND department. Some schools don't have a SEND department. They have special educators. As per the High Court order, every school should have a special educators, you know. Absolutely. And some school have a luxury to have a full SEND department. So I think the SEND department should be involved. Special educators should be involved along with teachers. and the parents should be involved into it. And I'm sure some of the schools are doing it and taking care of it. But yes, we know we have a big number of children with special needs, and we have a paucity of special educators and SEND departments. So, but yes, so I think there should be a accumulative effort of parents, teachers, special educators, and SEND department, and again addressing the capacity and individuality of the child. Correct. That is very important. It should be tailor-made.
One other issue I'd like to pose, which is that, and this is particularly true of adolescents, suddenly they're with their parents all the time. And this is not something that they're used to. As you were saying very rightly, you know, for them, school is so much about friends and about, you know, companionship, and they don't have that. Instead of that, they have parents with them all the time. So any guidance on that aspect, I think both sides, parents and children, we need to look at skills and approaches for those.
See, there are two ways. One, because now although the lockdown is almost moved to unlock one and the parents are getting busy back, they're working from homes now. But yes, but the initial part when the children and the parents were absolutely locked down, the real lockdown was happening in the month of end of March and the April and the early part of May. So what was happening is that because there were too much face off was there happening. So a lot of irritation, a lot of defiance, a lot of, arguments were happening between teenagers and the parents. So the first, again, golden rule is that maintain a boundary. How do you maintain a boundary? You know that if a teenager is working and you are working, just don't keep on coming and barging in between his life or her life. Give the space to each other, correct? And when you give a boundary to each other, so then what happens? You don't go into clashes. The moment you suddenly barge into it and you feel the child is always available to you freely. No, the child also have his own life. You also have your own life. Your spouse also have your own life, correct? We are living in 2020. So we have to understand that everybody has their own capacity and their own space. So when we are able to give space to each other, boundary to each other, and then second point is communicate with them a particular time, like lunchtime, dinner time, or tea time, or a family time, and talk it out, that whatever differences happened. And the third thing is that, which is very, very golden rule, which I learned from some of my seniors and my teachers and my friends, is that don't take your grudges to next day. If some grudges happen, some conflict happen, sort it out in the night time so that you have a peaceful sleep. And when you get up in the morning, you have a fresh day. Don't take it to the bed. So what happens? A good communication, maintaining a boundary, talking it out, having a schedule. And another point, responsibilities. So what I saw is that, including in my house and other parents also, they were involving their teenagers into various household chores. Some were cooking, some were baking, some were cleaning, some were mopping, some were cooking, some were laying the table, so some were doing, some were making the beds. So everybody was doing some responsibility. So it became the onus for everyone for the house. And then everybody became a part of the thing. So in that way, this is the way you can involve. So what I say is that the same thing like what the CBSC chairperson was talking, ex-CBSC chairperson, that make family as a unit and involve everyone. And these differences are always there a little bit. Differences keeps on coming, you know. We always know teenagers tend to get conflict with their parents. It's a very common affair, you know. We have also grown up as a teenager. We also get into conflict. We used to get conflict with the parents. Sort it out, talk it out, don't worry. They are your own children. Don't take them to heart, you know, and work it out, talk it out. And sometimes take a step back. If you are not able to settle it down, give it to your spouse, the responsibility. Give it to your wife. Or wife is not able to settle down, give it to your husband. And then sometime if you both are not able to settle down, both of them take step and give it to a sibling, the responsibilities. You do it. So that is a different permutation combination you can try.
So, Dr. Shalini, we have time for one last question.
Right. So I'm looking at the various questions that have come. One is, how do you deal with the irritation of students? You had talked, Dr. Gupta, earlier about that there was going to be higher levels of irritation and anger. in children, perhaps if you can talk about where that comes from and what we can do, either as teachers or at home, to deal with that, to manage that.
See, this irritation was not only limited to students. The irritation was also in teachers also. The irritation was also in parents also. And I can say from myself also, I also went through the part of this irritation. It was not only children. Everybody went through this irritation phase. Because it was such a new experience. Nobody was used to it. Nobody has spent so much time together in the lockdown for 2 months, three, 2.5 months, so much time in the four walls, and still they're spending time. Nobody was so much used to it. We have never seen partners and spouses and children so much the way we had. So it was an absolute new ball game. And when that came, we were not prepared. So irritation was natural. So one thing, the first thing is that accept it as a natural phenomenon. If it is happening, let it happen. That's okay. If you're having a mood swing, it's okay. If you're feeling a little bit of anxiety, it's okay. It's an absolutely a natural phenomena, which everyone is going, a lot of people are going through in this crisis. So welcome to the party. That's one thing. Second thing. The second thing you can pick up in irritation is that, which I always tell to everyone, is that ABC. Again, ABC. ABC means antecedent, B means behavior, C means consequence. So irritation is B. Look for what causes it, what triggers it. So what is that antecedent? What is the triggering factor? If triggering factor is a breakfast time, if triggering factor is too much of TV, or too much of mobile, if triggering factor is something about studies and homework, household chores, then you have to work on that A. Work on that A. The B will resolve. The third important part is that keep the home environment light. Use a lot of humor, a lot of fun. Don't keep it like a regime. Everybody's serious. No. Enjoy, have fun, tease, music, humor, have things together. So the home environment is lighter, then things are well. Fourth, if you're going to do yoga or meditation, that's very, very important. And the fifth, family time together. So if you do all these things, the irritation thermostat will go down gradually. Because irritation is just an output. It's a reaction to the situation. It's just a reactivity. So when you work on the B will automatically settle down.
Yeah. As we come to the end of this wonderful session, I would like to say that PeopleBridge, a digital marketing agency, has been providing a very wonderful platform to experts across different fields. And I'm sure all of you would have enjoyed today's session. Please join us again for the future sessions. We will have a different set of speakers as well, but we'll always welcome Dr. Deepa Gupta and Dr. Shalini to join in. Thank you both for a very nice session. I enjoyed it, and I'm sure our participants as well.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Shalini ji. Thank you, PeopleBridge. Thank you, Mahesh.
Thank you very much. And our platform today has over 350 participants from across the globe. And their questions are keeping on coming. I'm sure we would have loved a longer session, all of us. But that's it for today. Thank you, Dr. Deepak, again. And Dr. Shalini, thank you, Amitabh. Thank you, PeopleBridge. Thank you all. Right. Enjoy your evening and stay safe. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
And emails from PeopleBridge and connect with them, okay, across various channels. Thank you.